My name is Harlan Ellison. I'm a writer. I write books, I write movies. I've been doing it for about 35 years. They tell me that I'm world famous. I guess after 42 books and being translated into 26 languages, there is some small claim to that. My listing in Who's Who is larger than Ronald Reagan's, but we need not go into that. Let me point out this wall here in my study, in my library. This is a wall of books of art, ranging from alphabetically Art Deco at the top to, say, Van Gogh down at the bottom. But over here, in these two large bookcases, are titles that deal with comic books and comic strips. Now, there's a reason why they're together. It's not by chance. For me, comics have always been a kind of art, a very serious art. Here in America, for a long, long while, people thought of comic books only as throwaway, transient, kiddie stuff. But in Europe, where comic book artists are treated as classical artists, they recognize the importance of this Native American art form. You may find it peculiar that I call this a Native American art form. You see, there are only five really Native American art forms, ones that we've created ourselves, that are ours. There's the banjo, there's jazz, there's musical comedy as we understand it today, the mystery story as created by Edgar Allan Poe, and comic books. Now, I'm 52 years old, and I've been reading comics since, oh, I don't know, I guess 1938 when I bought my first one, which was maybe World's Fair comics with Superman and Batman. You may say, how peculiar for someone who likes to think of himself as one with Kafka and Poe to be thinking of comic books seriously. But let me tell you, I'm a comic book fan. I love comic books. Comic books were the training ground for me in terms of ethics, in terms of the things I learned about courage, good and evil, what heroism was, right and wrong. Comic books are the Grimm's fairy tales of the popular culture. They're done by serious people who care about the work they do, even as Van Gogh and Magritte and anyone else did. Today we're going to show you the work of 10 of the most important comic book artists who have ever lived. One of them's a Canadian, one of them's a Frenchman, the other 8 are Americans. This is very important stuff. Please stay with us. You're going to have a wonderful time. Picture this, if you will. You're looking across a distance of water at two men standing on a bridge far up in the darkness above you. One of them lights a cigarette, then the cigarette gets thrown over the bridge and the light comes toward you. One of the men hands the other a piece of paper. The first one looks at it, tears it into shreds, and throws it over the bridge, then pitches the first man over the bridge. As the body falls, the camera comes past you, and the pieces of paper spell out the words, "The Spirit." What I've just described to you is the kind of cinematic visual that a man named Will Eisner created for a strip called The Spirit. Will Eisner produced this strip in a Sunday supplement for years and years. Today, those strips are being reprinted, and they're as fresh as they ever were, because Will Eisner is, I suppose, the O. Henry of comic books. Every one of his little stories is complete. Beginning, middle, and an end with a punch that'll kill you. As far back as the 40s, when he had the Eisner-Iger Studios turning out page after page of comics, and then he went on his own and began doing The Spirit, Will Eisner has been one of the motivating forces in the genre of high art in comic books. Today, he does graphic novels, A Contract with God, Life Force. These are very special books that take place in the big city, the gritty, film noir kind of city that James M. Cain wrote about and that Dashiell Hammett wrote about. Will Eisner is a talent that appears once every 100 years.
I've always written genuinely. For me, it was writing short stories. The Spirit was somewhat different than what I had done before, or different in my mind from the average comic book hero. I wasn't really so much interested in creating a hero of enormous proportions, like Superman or Batman or any other superhero. I was more interested in telling short stories, or telling stories, or exposing an outlook. My main interest is the human condition. It always has been, and I fancy myself in a position to be able to write with my medium. Now, sequential art is a valid medium. I called it sequential art for want of a better name. I've always been annoyed from the very first day of my involvement in comics at the use of the word comics. Because comics is a misnomer. Comics should not be comical. They should not be necessarily funny, as in the case of funny papers. This is a valid medium of expression, equal in respectability, if you will, to words without pictures or to film. I compose the page as a single unit itself, almost like, again, I refer to music as really a best example of what I do. Each page has a rhythm to it. I deal in timing. I'm concerned with the amount of time it takes for a character to move from panel to panel. My main concern is not display. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in a series of moving images captured at their moment of prime motion to tell a story. I want to convey tears. I want to convey anger. I want to convey the subtleties that people who write with words only are able to convey more easily. Visual communication is the name of the game in this field, and that concerns me tremendously. I watch very carefully whenever I'm walking in the city or anywhere what people do and how they do it, because it's how they do it, how they stand, their postures, their gestures, that communicate their inner feelings. And I think of a panel as a stage with the proscenium arch and everything, and I arrange my figures in a panel in the same manner as a director would arrange actors on a given stage with entrances and movements. As far as lighting is concerned, wherever possible, I prefer to use theater lighting. I learned during the Depression, when I did some stage sets, that an enormous amount of scenery, an enormous amount of storytelling, visual storytelling, an enormous amount of environment can be suggested by clever lighting and by an arrangement of shapes and forms. I enjoy what I'm doing. I feel fulfilled when I've turned another corner. And there's just so much more yet to do. This medium is just at its infancy.
Harvey Kurtzman is the Peck's bad boy of comics. He is to dangerous satirical humor as Attila the Hun was to good table manners. Since the 1960s, he's been firing smart bombs into our cultural self-image in the pages of Playboy with a strip called Little Annie Fanny, created in collaboration with Will Elder. But back in the dim, dark 50s, he was one of the seminal creators, writers, and artists who brought us Mad Magazine. Mad began as nothing more than a comic book, one of those throwaway items that has now become a universally known element of the American literary scene. In the years following Mad, he created and he artistically controlled such magazines as Trump, Help, and Humbug, where he was sharp enough and influential enough to publish the first work of such underground artists as R. Crumb of Fritz the Cat fame, and Terry Gilliam, one of the Monty Python group, is now the director of such amazing films as Brazil, that owe such a large debt to Gilliam's comic book origins, guys like Jay Lynch and Skip Williamson. And because of this influence, Harvey has been called the father of the underground comic. I guess because of the potent influence Mad has had on three generations of American youth needful of satirizing the adult world, Kurtzman remains, to this day, one of the outstanding social critics, on a par with H.L. Mencken, Will Rogers, and Thomas Nast, the political cartoonist. He makes us laugh till it hurts, and more urgently, he makes us think till it hurts.
I came upon the Mad format because it was something that I did easily. I'd been doing all my life. I was known as the funny cartoonist in high school, the guy who used to do cartoons for everybody, make everybody laugh with cartoons. I mean, that's the way I got my my reason for being in high school. So I suggested that we go to a funny format. I was originally inspired by a couple of college yearbooks that I came across in somebody's garbage pail, I guess. And this was a revelation. The college yearbooks had been doing the kind of satire and parody that I wanted to do for years. Essentially, we did Mad for ourselves, so it became a very personalized effort, and we did very intimate things in our work. I liked Wally Wood's superhero stories that he did for Mad. Of course, Willie Elder, my ever loving partner, he would come up with these funny little asides that he set the style of putting a thousand little gags per square inch. Jack Davis, of course, was with his very slick, smooth technique and his marvelous brushwork and his humor. Jack was always a very humorous guy. There's so many things that were good. I get a great sense of satisfaction out of what Mad is supposed to have done. Sure, be a fool not to. If I didn't have that, what would I have? Little Annie Fanny. The way Little Annie Fanny started was, this was long after I'd left Mad. I'd been doing a comic strip for my own magazine, a magazine called Help. It was a comic strip called Goodman Beaver. Goodman Beaver was inspired by Voltaire Candide, you know, the boob that goes through life trying to think the best. So I went to Hefner and I said, what if we took my character and turned him around? Actually, it was Willie and myself that did Goodman Beaver. We turned him around and made him a woman with the same personality, the same problems. And Hefner said, bullseye, and that's the way it started. The way humor works to me is you do something to your reader or your audience that fills his balloon. It's as if you store energy and then release it with a bang. That's the basic structure of a joke, of a funny story. You invest your reader with some kind of energy, and then you do something to explode that energy, and that gives your reader a happiness, a good feeling. And that's to me is what, that's what humor is all about.
Jack Kirby is an important name for you to know, because Jack Kirby's career spans the entire history of comic books from the early 30s right up to today. Jack Kirby, when he began, had one of the most energetic styles of any artist. His work practically leaps off the page at you. In the 60s, he went to work for Marvel Comics, where he created the Fantastic Four, the Hulk, the Silver Surfer, and a host of other characters that you all know, in collaboration with a man named Stan Lee. This was the basis of the new Marvel House of Ideas, and it again revolutionized comics. And Marvel Comics became the most popular in the world. In the 70s, he worked for another comic house, DC, and created the Fourth World, Kirby's Fourth World. There were three comics, The Forever People, The New Gods, and Mr. Miracle. And in this triumvirate of comics, he created a whole new universe of characters with a lifestyle and with a philosophy. there. My name is Harlan Ellison. I'm a writer. I write books, I write movies. I've been doing it for about 35 years. They tell me that I'm world famous. I guess after 42 books and being translated into 26 languages, there is some small claim to that. My listing in Who's Who is larger than Ronald Reagan's, but we need not go into that. Let me point out this wall here in my study, in my library. This is a wall of books of art, ranging from alphabetically Art Deco at the top to, say, Van Gogh down at the bottom. But over here, in these two large bookcases, are titles that deal with comic books and comic strips. Now, there's a reason why they're together. It's not by chance. For me, comics have always been a kind of art, a very serious art. Here in America, for a long, long while, people thought of comic books only as throwaway, transient, kiddie stuff. But in Europe, where comic book artists are treated as classical artists, they recognize the importance of this Native American art form. Now, you may find it peculiar that I call this a Native American art form. You see, there are only five really Native American art forms, ones that we've created ourselves that are ours. There's the banjo, there's jazz, there's musical comedy as we understand it today, the mystery story as created by Edgar Allan Poe, and comic books. Now, I'm 52 years old, and I've been reading comics since, oh, I don't know, I guess 1938 when I bought my first one, which was maybe World's Fair comics with Superman and Batman. You may say, how peculiar for someone who likes to think of himself as one with Kafka and Poe to be thinking of comic books seriously. But let me tell you, I'm a comic book fan. I love comic books. Comic books were the training ground for me in terms of ethics, in terms of the things I learned about courage, good and evil, what heroism was, right and wrong. Comic books are the Grimm's fairy tales of the popular culture. They're done by serious people who care about the work they do, even as Van Gogh and Magritte and anyone else did. Today we're going to show you the work of 10 of the most important comic book artists who have ever lived. One of them's a Canadian, one of them's a Frenchman, the other eight are American.
Evolvement. From what I understand, the editorial comic was first, and then they added a few panels to that and you had a comic strip. And they added a few pages to that and you had a comic book. And what we can add to the comic book? We may have to think about that. So I believe that's the interesting part of the entire field, is to say, what is it? Where is it going? How will it evolve? And we experiment with that every day.
Steve Ditko began his career in the 50s and enjoyed enormous popularity almost from the first because of his style, which seems to cram into one panel more than any human eye can contain. He went to work in the early 60s for Marvel Comics, and there he was put to work on a number of different strips, most importantly, Spider-Man. And the quality of his art and the peculiarity of his art, the individuality of his art, made it the most popular costumed hero in the field very, very quickly. But it was his work on a character called Doctor Strange, a magician, a mage, a man who was possessed of supernatural powers that brought him into the greatest prominence. He's an interesting man, and the strips that he creates of his own, when he's not just illustrating other people's writing, are very interesting. He has a very highly defined sense of good and evil, right and wrong. There are no gray areas for him. There is a character called Mr. A, that Steve Ditko created that would give Charles Bronson nightmares for vigilantism. To Steve Ditko, the artist is the work, and the work is the telling of the story. And to this end, he would like to make the following statement.
Mr. A is based on Ayn Rand's theory of justice, on Aristotle's law of identity, his definition of man, and his view of art. Aristotle said that art is philosophically more important than history. History tells how men did act. Art shows how men could and should act. Art creates a model. An ideal man is a measuring standard. Without a measuring standard, nothing can be identified or judged, but everything can be measured. Disease and sicknesses are measured by a healthy organ or body. All measurement requires an appropriate standard. With it, one can measure down to atoms, up to the stars, and the changes in the character of a man. Aristotle defined man as a rational animal. Rationality is a potential that has to be actualized by choice and the right thinking method of logic applied to reason. The standard of measurement for all is the rational logical ruler. It objectively measures the rational and irrational thinking. A hero measures a man at his best in the worst situations. A hero is a man admired for his qualities or achievements and regarded as an ideal or model. Aristotle formulated the law of identity. A is A. A thing is what it is. It has a specific nature and identity. The truth cannot contradict itself and also be a lie. Mr. A's black and white card symbolizes the law of identity. It identifies the two moral potentials possible, the good and the evil. And by one's chosen action, the best or the worst potential can be actualized. The card is also a symbol of justice. For Ayn Rand, justice is objectively identifying a thing for what it is and treating it accordingly. No one gets the unearned. The innocent is not penalized, the guilty is not rewarded. The card is a refusal to violate the root of justice, the law of identity, by a gray compromise, a refusal to sacrifice the good to the evil or to accept any part of the evil as a greater good. Society has its admirable people, its heroes. They are found in all professions. But hidden by the complexities of society, they are not as clearly defined, not as understood, and not as effective model as a story with two opposing forces of right and wrong in a dramatic presentation, revealing the characters' choices and actions that identify them and lead to a just ending where the hero and the right view of life wins. Early comic book heroes were not about life as it is, but creations of how a man with a clear understanding of right and wrong and more courage chose to act, even if branded an outlaw. He dispensed a better justice than a pervading legal moral one. He was a moral avenger. He was not like everyone else, not the average, the common, or the ordinary man. He was the exceptional one, the uncommon one, the one doing what others were unwilling to do, regardless of the opposition and consequences to himself. His success provided a better model. Through a hero, one could identify the foolish, the corrupt, and the guilty. A lead character can be better or worse than society's best model, and if a man with proven better qualities appears, then a new measuring standard for men and society is established. A hero is a model for everyone, but not everyone is willing to act at his best. A less demanding model, blending good and bad, is more comforting, easier to accept. For the self-flawed, an anti-hero provides a heroic label without the need to act better. A crooked cop, a flawed cop, is not a valid model of a good law enforcer. An anti-cop corrupts the legal good, an anti-hero corrupts the moral good. Both corrupt ideals. Both choose the flaw over the perfect. The perfect is identified and measured by what is possible to man, a perfect bowling score. A perfect response accepts the truth and rejects the lie. The perfect hero on principle says yes to a true identity and no to a contradictory one. Ruled by justice, he treats every identity as it deserves. He is the actualized potential for good in its purest form, a true moral measuring ruler. He is the most human and deserving of respect. Today's flawed superheroes are superior in physical strength, but common, average, ordinary in mental strength, rich in superpowers, but bankrupt in reasoning powers. They are perfect in overcoming the flawed supervillains, saving the world, the universe, yet help us to solve their common, ordinary, average personal problems. It is like creating a perfectly physical adult with the reasoning limits of a 6-year-old. The creators of flawed ideals believe that no real difference exists between a flawed hero and a flawed villain. Both have some good and some bad in them, so they blend into a grayness where no one is better than anyone else, and where the worst can justifiably claim that he is as good as gray as the best. If it is impossible to know what is true and to do what is right, then the flaw, the worst, will be the new standard of good. Man will be defined as a flawed anti-rational animal, and all that corrupts and harms life will be the new virtues. Like deliberately flawed eyesight, where self-blindness is the ideal, anti-life behavior will be the new standard for living. The resentment against the perfect hero is a resentment against A is A, against the integration of truth and behavior, against the non-contradictory identity of a moral ideal, against reality and life's measuring ruler, a rational moral standard.
Neil Adams brought realism and believability to the superhero genre when he began working in comic books in the mid-60s. He changed the face of the art form by coupling photorealism with dynamic action. In the pages of a comic called Dead Man, he began experimenting with page layout and form. And he did some astonishing work with Denny O'Neill on Green Lantern and Green Arrow. Very high social conscience in that strip, all through the 60s, during the days of upheaval in this country, reflecting what our nation was going through. And then he went to work on the X-Men and the Avengers. And then, most importantly, he rescued the Batman from the swamp of television camp to which the Batman had sunk. And he made him once again the Dark Knight detective, a creature of night in the city, a creature that criminals would fear, the Batman we know today. He's currently publishing his own line of comic books for Continuity Graphics.
Dead Man was an opportunity to experiment with page format and layout. And I got a little radical on it. I have to admit, it was probably totally rambunctious and out of order for me to do, but I think probably the opportunity to stretch the medium a little bit, to create compositions that were in a medium that was truly its own medium. It wasn't like film where you could only see one picture at a time. It wasn't like comic strips, which I had done for a period of time and I was limited to a certain format. Here was a big rectangular page and I could do anywhere between one drawing and 10 drawings on that page. And I could compose the page any way I wanted to. And I had certain attitudes about composing pages, which I had developed doing a syndicated strip, and I felt that I could lead the eye, that I could catch the reader and I could make him read the way I wanted him to read, that I could make him stop when I wanted him to stop by composing the pictures a certain way, that I could actually become one with the reader. If he was willing to go with me, if he was willing to read what I was doing, then I could, if I could just grab him by the throat, then he would follow and read in the way I wanted him to read. Dead Man was perhaps the most successful experiment in that area. You can read a Dead Man comic book and you almost unconsciously know when I want you to slow down or when I want you to speed up. You almost unconsciously know when I want you to slide through panels or when I want you to jump through panels. Just as a director will handle a different type of story a different way, our job as the artist and writer at times is to tell the story the way it suits the story. After all, as Shakespeare would say, the play is the thing. It's not the artist, it's not the director, it's not the producer, it's the story. If you're not faithful to the story, if the play isn't the thing, then why are you doing it in the first place? Well, in comic books, as with film, as with everything else, we're all servants of the story. We can warp the story, we can make it incorrect, or we can do it in a way that we believe is correct. If people agree with us, they'll like it. If they don't agree with us, they'll hate us. And in my case, I've been very lucky. People have liked the things that I've done. Batman was originally created by Bob Kane and Bill Finger and Jerry Robinson as this creature of the night who would scare the bejesus out of anybody he ran across, and criminals in particular. Whether or not he was right or whether this would work, that's what he did. That was what Batman was all about. And that's what I tried to return him to. So I think that one could say that Frank Miller, working on Batman now, has done more to make a more solid character out of Batman. At that time, at the time I entered my little editorialism into it, what I did was I brought him back to what he was supposed to be. Now people are playing with it within that framework, and I think doing a very good job. A comic book is as good as a writer who's sincerely talented and tries hard, and an artist who is very talented and tries very hard can make it. That's how good it can be. So if you put a good artist and a good writer together, and they try really hard to do something good, it just got to be a good comic book. And it can't be trash. It can only be viewed as trash by people who think of it that way. The things that are presented in comic books are good. The ideals are real and good. And kids like them. They're, as far as I know, the only medium outside of perhaps movies, the only reading medium that a kid will take money out of his own pocket and buy. Because he wants to read it. He'll even go to the dictionary to look up a word so he knows what this guy says. There's something important there. And Europeans think Americans are missing the boat. Maybe we are.
I want to talk about Bernie Wrightson. He's been called the master of the macabre. He's been influenced by the classic horror films, the black and white Universal films, and EC comic books of the 1950s. You probably will know Bernie Wrightson best from a comic book that he created with the fine writer Len Wein called Swamp Thing, which is one of the great myth images in comic books today. This is a man whose work is filled with demons and monsters and ghouls and aliens and werewolves. And in black and white, he has illustrated the works of Edgar Allan Poe and H.P. Lovecraft. He did two projects with Stephen King. One of them was a comic adaptation of George Romero's film Creepshow, and the other is a book called Cycle of the Werewolf, which you may have seen as a movie called Silver Bullet. But Bernie's most important work was his interpretation of Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley's Frankenstein, in which he visualized the monster using only the novel.
Essentially, what I was trying to do with the illustrations in Frankenstein was I was trying to limit myself to the techniques that were in use that at the time that the book was originally written, say around the beginning of the 19th century, which would have been steel engravings or woodcuts. I was trying to pinpoint an archetype. Trying to put myself into the mind of Mary Shelley, maybe more into her time, of what would have been frightening to someone in Mary Shelley's time. I think painting is probably a more natural way of reproducing an image on a two-dimensional surface, whereas working in line is just goes completely against all the rules. I mean, my hand exists in space as form and tone and color and bulk. It doesn't have a black line around it. It doesn't have little lines cross-hatched across it to make this side darker than that side. So working in line, working in black and white is much more of an abstraction than working in color, than painting. As far as being a picture maker or an image maker, what always comes first is a picture in my mind. I always see something very definitely inside. I always see it exactly the way I draw it. And the finished product is almost always like I had an opaque projector that was in my head projecting out through my eyes on the paper, and all I do is trace the picture that I see. When the Batman made an appearance in the Swamp Thing series, that was an awful lot of fun for me, because I had been wanting to do Batman for quite a long time, but I didn't want to do Batman in his own book, in his own story, and this was perfect for me, because now Batman could be a guest star in my book, and I felt that since he was just a guest in my little universe, I had total control over him. I could do anything with him that I wanted. So I decided to make his ears 2 feet long and to make his cape 30 feet long in certain shots where it just looked good to have this huge tent of a cape blowing in the wind. And nobody argued with me. you know, because it was my interpretation. It was the Swamp Thing lived in his own little universe, his own kind of alternate universe, and the Batman comes in, and it's like walking through a distorting mirror or something, and Batman had to bend to the rules of this universe. And suddenly become, you know, this very, you know, kind of twisted, monstrous thing. Horror is different things to different people, I think. To me, in spite of my drawings of monsters and the creeping dead crawling out of their graves and vampires and Frankenstein's monster and whatnot, horror to me is an image of a well-dressed man standing on a corner waiting for a bus, and everything about him is absolutely perfect, except there's a spot of blood on his shoe.
We have a gentleman from France with us today. His name is Jean Giraud. He's also known as Moebius, or Mobius, depending on how well you speak French. And he's considered to be one of Europe's greatest illustrators. His styles are as varied as the many names under which he's worked. But as a comic book artist, he first came to prominence with Lieutenant Blueberry. It was a vast epic that was filled with all the myths and glorious characters of the Old West, which have fascinated Moebius. In the late 60s, under the name Moebius, Giraud began illustrating a line of French science fiction books and magazines, and his style was an epiphany for people in Europe and in America. In the early 70s, he returned to comic books with a number of seminal breakthrough science fiction and fantasy stories that were later to influence an entire generation of new artists. For the pages of Metal Hurlant, which is a French graphic illustrated magazine, and Metal Hurlant literally means screaming metal, he created new fantasy sagas such as Arzak and the Airtight Garage of Jerry Cornelius. His influence then spread to America when the people who published the National Lampoon brought out their version of Metal Hurlant, a magazine called Heavy Metal, which is still being published today. He's currently living in America, and he continues to explore new concepts, new dreams, and experiments in very strange storytelling.
I arrived at the name Moebius because I had two styles so different. And when I did that, I was very young, and for me it was a kind of joke, you know, and I wanted to do that maybe for a few times and maybe change the name every time. And I was not looking for fame and fortune, I was only trying to have fun. I had to do something because I was involved in a kind of commercial art, very specific in point of view of style. I wanted to escape that. I wanted to be free and to start a story in a style, maybe finish in another one, and not to know exactly what I was doing, you know, trying to dream awake in the drums. So I had to find another signature to do that. Arzak is the first result of that direction. You know, it's the first story really with a good structure and with the complete freedom into that new country of dreams. So it's a very, it's crazy story. It's very famous in France. The comics gives to the artist a very interesting field of expression and research. And everything is possible, everything. You can be very small or very big, and you can be very modest or very ambitious. You can be you can stay in a regular style, like everybody doing your best in that way, or you can escape and be completely unusual and incredible. You can give more to the words and give more to the drawing. You can do everything. But you know, it's like in any art. The possibility of the art are big, but the possibility of the artist are bigger or smaller. It's the artist who have the possibility to append to make a pressure in order to be more responsible of what they do. Because to be more responsible is to be more adult, to be more mature, to be more evaluate. If you don't want to be responsible, if you only want to make a job, to have money, to feed your family, it's a kind of responsibility too. But if you want to stay in that field, all the comics will stay, you know, that because it's not the publisher who will push, and it's not the public. It's the artist. The artist must be the warrior, you know, who fight.
I want to tell you about my pal Frank Miller. This is a name you're going to know because you'll have seen pieces in Rolling Stone, the New York Times. Frank Miller burst on the scene in comics in the 70s. He got tired of looking at comic books in which the superhero was taken for granted. He began by working on a comic book called Daredevil, which he reinvented and brought from the depths of no sales right to the peak of popularity. After his success with Daredevil, he created a book of his own called Ronin, which is a fully realized futuristic novel that goes all the way back in time to ancient Japan and all the way forward into an Orwellian 1984 kind of future. And he revolutionized what comic books looked like by utilizing the best paper and coloring processes. Then last year, he took one of the most deeply established icons, Batman, and he said, what would this man be like as he was nearing 60 and had not been a crime fighter for, say, 10, 15, 20 years? And he did The Dark Knight Returns, which is now a book published by Warner Books that is an astonishing document. It revolutionizes comic art, and it revolutionizes the way we think about comic books. This is Frank Miller. He's hot. Better take a look at him.
We've got to keep in mind that the main image people have of superheroes is Adam West playing Batman on the old TV show. That's what had to be overcome. But the idea itself is valuable. And it's also a hell of a lot of fun to write and draw. If you get it back to what the substance of the idea is, if you remember that Superman began as a common man against the forces of evil in the world, which were largely forces of authority back in the 30s. And you go back to when Batman was a vigilante who carried a gun on his hip back in the 30s again. You start seeing what a strong chord they can strike. Much of the stuff that Clint Eastwood, Charles Bronson, and others are doing now is kind of a right-wing version of those old comic books. And Dark Knight was really an attempt to take it back a lot in terms of the basic meat of the material, and at the same time bring it forward in terms of the world it lives in, the kind of fiction that you can do now. I really enjoyed the idea of making him as old as his legend is, and letting it be a cranky old legend, you know, this ravenous old hero. I wanted to bring back that you know, hearty sense of malice that he had back in his origins. Ronin, for me, was absolute proof this can be a terrific field to work in, and this is a great time to do comics. I had a publisher give me free rein creatively. Terrific production values. I was able to work in collaboration with Lynn Varley, the painter, who was able to bring unheard of dimension to the color art. And I was able to charge into this form, into this project with this art form that's been in suspended animation for so damn long that most people don't think it has a that it could possibly be any good. And I was able to play with it. I was able to twist things around, to bring in subjects and themes and graphic methods from sources far flung. On top of that, I had been exposed to what was going on in Japan in the comic books and in France. And the work of Mobius in France and the work of Gosuke Kojima in Japan, both of these collided on me at roughly the same time and came right out in Ronin. It was a playground and it was a nightmare, and it was a wonderful project to work on. Nothing could have taught me more. Nothing could have made me feel better about the form or make me feel more committed about this as my art form than Ronin. In the 40s, when comic books started really taking off, there was an assembly line system set up in order to produce them more rapidly. And since you know, comics have generally regarded themselves as junk quality, it was not that much of a consideration. The outstanding comics have generally been done by one person who writes and draws, Will Eisner being a preeminent example. I believe it is one art. However, I don't believe that that's the only way it can be done. And my collaborations with Lynn Varley, with David Mazzucchelli, with Bill Sienkiewicz, have taught me that thrilling things happen when another artist is at work, when you're playing off somebody, when you get those surprises, and when you get those problems you kind of solve. I think it's too early, for me anyway, certainly for me, to make any hard and fast statements about which way the art should be done better, because every project I do seems to be different. I'm also very new at this, and maybe I could give you a better definition of the best way to do the form in about 30 years, so get back to me.
Dave Sim has created a character. I'm not quite sure if you'll get this. He's got a character called Cerebus the Aardvark. This is a talking, barbarian, sword-wielding aardvark, and there's a whole universe that Dave has created for him. And Dave has done this as his life's work. He's committed himself to doing 300 issues of his comic, Cerebus the Aardvark. Every month, he publishes the book himself. Now, nearly a third of the way through this epic, Dave has already completed three full novels, Cerebus the Barbarian, High Society, which is a marvelous antic thing that features a character who looks like Groucho Marx, and Church and State, in which he becomes the Pope. The story blends elements of satire, humor, politics, popular culture, and mystery, supported by a unique cast of characters who move in and out of the book purposely and with motive. As entertainment, Cerebus succeeds on a lot of different levels. It's very sophisticated, and it's pure communication.
It's a roller coaster ride. So anything that makes for a good roller coaster, I'll put in the book. There's very few things that I will dismiss out of hand. Oh, that doesn't belong in Cerebus. If you're making something your life's work, you're going to find a way to put just about everything that's important to you into it in one regard or another. And I'm finding that out of the, 30 some odd thousand people that read the book, most of them are pretty simpatico to that. I'm talking about their stuff. Like, I'm talking as a baby boomer. I don't watch adventure films. I don't watch genre films for the most part. It's two people in a room. For years, Talking Heads was a pejorative. I think David Byrne has helped a great deal in establishing, hey, that's what it is. I mean, if you're going to do a film or a comic book or any other entertainment that doesn't have just two people talking, you're missing the whole essence of what's human. I mean, we are human because we sit and talk. How many fist fights does the average person get into in their lifetime? How many people go, flying off their balcony? How many people get into a car chase? These become cliches in entertainment and virtually non-existent in real life, which to me makes it, what makes that art then? Art is supposed to be something that speaks to the human condition, and you see very little of the human condition in most popular culture. The Cerberus the Barbarian part of the storyline is really a series of very short episodes. They're either single issue stories or I think out of the first 25 there's a couple of 3-issue stories. Basically we discover the character as a mercenary thief, former tax collector, layabout, drunkard, gambler, basically unsavory individual, no ambition, no place that he wants to go. Through the course of high society, he arrives at the Regency Hotel still very much the barbarian. I mean, the desk clerk says, you know, if you leave your bag, someone will take it. And he says that's why Cerberus is keeping it with him. You know, it's a way of establishing that he's really not in this league. But then because of previous political connections that he had through the Cerberus the Barbarian story, it becomes apparent that he's thought of as some very canny behind-the-scenes manipulator, you know, one of the chosen successors to the powers that be, all of those kind of things. He changes as he goes along, pretty much as the wind shift. He's in a lot of ways, Cerberus is the consummate politician that way. Whatever he sees happening, or whatever phrase he picks up, or whatever he will use to death. So it becomes sort of a cross between Richard Nixon and Chauncey Gardner. You know, it's somebody who really doesn't know what he's doing, but somehow everything keeps rolling his way. It strikes me as a kind of an interesting thing to document for 26 years. 26 years.
An interesting artist is Art Spiegelman, who does not work in any of the ordinary forms that you associate with comic books. Spiegelman can be found these days on the pages of the New York Times Book Review, where a graphic novel he did called Mouse is getting serious attention. It's a book that examines the lives of his father and mother and his relationship with them. In the world of Mouse, Jews are drawn as mice, Nazis as cats, to depict the horrors of Hitler's reign. And these were incidents that were witnessed firsthand by Art Spiegelman's father, a survivor of the Holocaust. Spiegelman has always been on the cutting edge of comic book art. He emerged from the underground cartoonists of the 60s, and he co-founded the magazine Arcade in the 1970s. In 1980, feeling that there was no longer an outlet for new work by these artists, new and dangerous, daring, experimental work, he co-founded Raw magazine, which is an international potpourri of graphic storytelling and avant-garde printing techniques. Through Mouse, however, Spiegelman has been able to break new ground in the comic book medium because it has drawn attention to this form for an audience that would otherwise have ignored comic books. Serious-minded people who would read Jane Austen but who would never look at an issue of Daredevil have found Mouse and have found it to be art.
When I took Mouse on, it was a result of feeling myself at a bit of an impasse. Over the previous 7 or 8 years, I found myself working in a more and more specialized way for an audience that seemed smaller and smaller, and that the things that were interesting to me were very hard to get across to people who didn't have the same background. I had the same way of understanding what's happening on a comic page. And although those things remained of interest to me, I figured, well, gee, if I keep going this way, I won't have to be doing stuff for print. I'll be able to just put it up on a wall somewhere. And the 10 or 12 people who are really interested in that will have to find that wall. So I figured, okay, I give up. If comics are about telling a story, I'll just sit down and make myself tell a story. It's such a long and involved process that it wasn't something I was eager to enter into just to tell one more
escapist adventure story or one more joke. It's just too much work for that. So I had to find a story that was really important enough for me to enter into fully, and something difficult enough to keep me challenged throughout. And Mouse seemed like about the most challenging thing I could undertake. In Mouse specifically, I've approached it by wanting to be in the service of a story. And what that meant was trying to understand and structure and organize that story as fully as possible before I even started thinking about how it can happen box to box. I wanted to report on my father's past, and to a degree my mother's. I wanted to report on my relationship with my father. And trying to deal with those themes meant being a writer first and a cartoonist second, so that I found in Mouse the pictures are totally in service of the story insofar as I can make that happen. So they're very quiet compared to other comic books and compared to other things that I've done. When I'm drawing Mouse, I end up working on typing paper. I use a fountain pen and liquid paper to white it out. I want to feel like I'm writing, so I'm using stationery supplies. I'm drawing very small. The drawings that appear inside the book, which are, whatever, 6 inches by 9 inches, something like that, are the actual size that I'm working, so that there's no, there's less of an intermediary. What usually happens is a cartoonist tends to work rather large, 12 inches by 18 or something, and in the process of printing it and reducing it, there's a kind of refinement. It ends up looking a little crisper, a little more, in quotes, professional, and the result is a distancing between the reader and the creator. And here I really wanted it to be more like the mark I make is the mark you see. So it would be more like picking up on a journal and looking over one's shoulder to read that journal. And to me, that's part of the intimacy the comics are capable of. And that intimacy is something that was very necessary for me in this particular strip. Since all we're really talking about is we're talking about words and pictures, they're plastered together somehow. They're, a structure is made of those words and pictures. And that can contain a comics equivalent to Beethoven as well as a comics equivalent to Van Halen. It's open. All it really is a medium, and then it becomes as strong, as potent as the artists within it. And I'd like to see it move away from genre fiction. I'd like to see it move away from obsessive recapitulation of the same fantasies over and over again. So on the one hand, I'd like to see subject matter more reflective of what people's actual situations are. I'd like to see it grapple with more difficult moral and political issues. I'd like to see it deal with more personal issues throughout. And I'd like to see it develop aesthetically. I'd like to see people whose background isn't so solely drawn from comic books, that all that can be spit back is more comic books, third, fourth, fifth generation comic book vision, something that has its roots more in reality, inner and outer.